We all know that Ethereum is one of the gods in the cryptoverse, and that Vitalik Buterin is the godfather. But Vitalik isn't some 50-year-old programmer or mathematician like many other tech founders. Vitalik is only 28 years old. He first entered the crypto scene at 17, proposed Ethereum at 19, and launched the beast at 21. Today, Ethereum's market cap is $238 billion. And on top of that, Vitalik has already donated over $1 billion to charity as well. All this is incredibly impressive, but how did it start? Stick around until the end, as we'll dive into the story of Vitalik Buterin and how he built Ethereum. Also, if you enjoy crypto content, consider subscribing or liking the video. I spend a lot of time doing research like this, and only a small percentage of my viewers are subscribed. It's free, and you can always unsubscribe. Vitalik Buterin was born in Koloma, Russia, on January 31st, 1994. He experienced some of his early life in Russia. But the majority of his formative years were spent in Canada, where his family relocated when Vitalik was 6 years old. It was evident from the start that Vitalik was not your typical kid in third grade. Vitalik was accepted into a program for gifted students, and many of his teachers were astonished by his math and programming skills. Unfortunately, Vitalik fit the cliche of a nerd who was antisocial. But that changed when he started playing World of Warcraft. It was Vitalik's favorite way to enjoy his downtime. Gaming does have a lot of stigma attached to it because many consider it a waste of time with little to no practical value. However, Vitalik discovered the crypto world through World of Warcraft. According to the story, Blizzard, the creator of World of Warcraft, deleted the damage component of Vitalik's famed Warlock Siphon Life skill in 2010. This change hurt Vitalik so much that he cried himself to sleep that night for the first time. This made Vitalik recognize the limits of a centralized structure, leading him into the crypto space. The next year, when Vitalik was first exposed to Bitcoin, he claims that, like most of us, he was hesitant. His main issue with Bitcoin was that it had no physical backing. How could an immaterial asset have any value? However, when Vitalik explored more, he realized that the same case could be made about fiat currencies as well. So to understand more about crypto, Vitalik got a job writing for Bitcoin Weekly when he was 17. He was only paid $1.50 per hour, but since he wasn't in it for the money, he didn't mind. Plus, he was getting paid in Bitcoin. The magazine's owner paid him 5 Bitcoins for every article, which was only worth about $3.50 at the time. So Vitalik was earning about 2.1 Bitcoins per hour. In hindsight, considering today's Bitcoin value, it's absolutely crazy. Unfortunately, Bitcoin Weekly was closed down due to a lack of money. However, by the time the magazine ended, Vitalik had made a reputation for himself in the crypto industry. So when a crypto fanatic named Mihai Alesi decided to launch his own Bitcoin magazine, Vitalik was one of the first picks. Mihai invited Vitalik to join him in co-founding Bitcoin magazine and become the magazine's chief writer. And just like that, at the age of 17, Vitalik launched his first business in September 2011. Vitalik worked nearly full-time on this project, spending 30 hours per week researching crypto, blogging about crypto, and working on other crypto projects. Despite working on crypto day and night, Vitalik did not neglect his studies. He continued to excel in high school and even won a bronze medal in the International Olympiad in Informatics in 2012. After high school, Vitalik attended the University of Waterloo, but crypto took over his life. He traveled the world to meet with crypto experts and write about their thoughts and views for his magazine. Vitalik began to notice a common set of concerns and problems related to crypto projects. Most cryptocurrencies were designed for specialized applications and were not broadly useful outside of their niches. Vitalik believed that by replacing the present protocols with the Turing-complete programming language, the problem could be easily solved. Vitalik pitched his idea to all of the existing projects with whom he had built relationships, but none of them were interested. So in late 2013, Vitalik decided to do it himself. He described his Ethereum vision in a white paper, which he shared with his crypto buddies. His buddies then shared it with their buddies, and before long, a large chunk of the crypto world was discussing Ethereum's possibilities. The positive response was uplifting, but Vitalik wasn't ready to dive. Yes, he had a business and possibly had dozens of Bitcoins, but they weren't worth much at the time. Vitalik got some financing through the Teal Fellowship, which gives $100,000 to young individuals who want to develop new things instead of taking classes. And yes, he won the $100,000, but it was nothing compared to the Ethereum empire he has built over the years. Vitalik, Mihai, Gavin Wood, and a few other crypto fanatics began working on Ethereum in January 2014. Charles Hoskinson, who is now the founder of Cardano, was also a co-founder of the Ethereum blockchain. At the 2014 Bitcoin conference, Vitalik introduced an improved version of Ethereum. A few months later, the team held an initial coin offering to raise additional funds for the project. I don't know how much money they hoped to generate, However, it appears their ICO was a massive hit. The team raised a stunning $18 million by selling 31,000 bitcoins worth of Ether. You probably won't be surprised to know that Vitalik dropped out of college. Following this exceptional investment round, the team grew over the next year. The platform and the majority of Ethereum were formally introduced in July of 2015. Keep in mind that Ethereum is only a platform. The cryptocurrency that most people refer to as Ethereum is actually called Ether. Although there was a lot of excitement surrounding Ethereum's introduction, it didn't take too long for problems to emerge, with the first notable one being the DAO attack in 2016. A Decentralized Autonomous Organization, or DAO, raised funds to launch an Ethereum-based venture capital firm. At the time, it was one of the most anticipated projects. In fact, the DAO was so popular that it received 14% of all Ethereum circulation. This amounted to almost $150 million. Less than 3 months after its launch, the DAO would be hacked and $60 million stolen through a coding flaw, and the DAO's wallet smart contracts could be leveraged to drain. As this major security flaw was thrown out on Ethereum as a whole, the cash in the DAO's wallet was one life-threatening danger. Ethereum might have been destroyed because of the DAO attack. Vitalik, on the other hand, was focused on preventing this from happening. Vitalik first proposed a soft fork, so previously valid transaction blocks might be made invalid by the soft fork. However, he needed the majority of miners' support to successfully execute the fork. The hackers responded after hearing about the plan. They said that it was not their fault there was a security breach and that the cash they took was obtained fairly. The hackers offered to pay miners 1 million Ether to prevent a soft fork from being executed. Thus, Vitalik was forced to consider a hard fork. A hard fork occurs when a significant change is made to a blockchain network and miners and users have an option to choose between the original and new paths. Vitalik could compensate the investors with new protocol tokens, but this was very controversial. Cryptocurrencies were designed to be decentralized, and a hard fork would obviously violate this philosophy. Nonetheless, Vitalik carried out the hard fork on July 20th, 2016, which is why there are two primary Ethereum tokens today, Ethereum Classic, or ETC, and Ether, or ETH. This enabled Vitalik to restore all of the stolen funds to the investors via the new ETH token. The hackers kept possession of the ETC coins they stole, but because everyone was dumping ETC, their share had dropped to $8.5 million, which is still a significant sum, but I don't think there was a better way to deal with that problem. Since then, Vitalik has tried to be more proactive with updating Ethereum, and that brings us to the latest development of Ethereum 2.0. Ethereum 2.0 is designed to reduce energy consumption. The transaction costs and transaction speeds of Ethereum are the keys to accomplishing this. By switching from proof of work to proof of stake, Ethereum will be able to eliminate the huge energy consumption needed for mining Ethereum 2.0. The initial phases began in December 2020. However, the entire transition is not planned until sometime in the latter stages of 2022, perhaps even next year. Many people believe that Ethereum 2.0 will be the spark that drives Ether ahead of Bitcoin in terms of market capitalization, but only time will tell how that one goes. Today, we don't know the exact value of Vitalik's crypto assets, but his net worth was believed to be between $1 billion and $3 billion at one point. However, Vitalik has declared recently that he is no longer a billionaire after the recent crypto wipeout. Billionaire or not, Vitalik hasn't been reluctant to share his fortune. For example, he gave $1.14 billion worth of Shiba Inu to India's COVID relief fund in May 2020. With that kind of soul, I believe Vitalik's successes are more than deserved. Do you guys think Ether will overtake Bitcoin? Write flippening in the comments if you believe so. And if you learned something new from this, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon to be the first to see our new videos. I make deep dives like this every week where I uncover the secrets of money and business.